নমস্কার, শুভ অপরাহ্ন, এ ভেরি গুড আফটারনুন টু অল অফ ইউ। অন বিহাফ অফ অর্গানাইজিং কমিটি, আই মিন্টু হালদার, কনভেনার অফ দিস ওয়েবিনার, কর্ডিয়ালি ইনভাইট ইউ অল ইন দ্য ওয়েবিনার অন মুক অনলাইন টিচিং লার্নিং অ্যান্ড ইভ্যালুয়েশন। ওয়েবিনার ইজ অর্গানাইজড জয়েন্টলি বাই ইনফোলিড একাডেমিয়া ইন কোলাবোরেশন উইথ ভৈরব গাঙ্গুলি কলেজ। ম্যাসিভ ওপেন অনলাইন কোর্সেস আর ওয়ান অফ দ্য মোস্ট প্রমিনেন্ট ট্রেন্ডস ইন হায়ার এডুকেশন ইন রিসেন্ট ইয়ার্স। The term MOOCs represents are a new type of online class that allow anyone anywhere to participate via video lectures, computer graded tests and discussion forums. MOOCs are stated to be online versions of a textbook. MOOCs are claimed not to prepare learners to create, generate, solve and innovate. In India has started various projects for offering MOOCs courses. Currently NPTEL, MOOC IT, IIT BX are in the platform used in India for offering courses. The University Grants Commission along with HRD Ministry has launched the MOOC program in India for higher education, secondary, bachelor's and master degrees. This will cover a wide range of subjects that may or may not be taught in regular campus studies. A new portal for MOOCs named is Study Wave of Active Learning for Young Aspiring Minds, in short SWYOM. Millions of people around the world use MOOCs to learn for a variety of reasons, including career development, changing careers, college preparation, supplemental learning, lifelong learning, corporate e-learning and training and more. Today's topic is extremely relevant in the current situation. I will not waste any more time. In this program, the name of the resource persons are Dr. Biplab Chakraborty, Professor, Department of Library Information Science, University of Calcutta, Dr. Tapan Kumar Mondol, Deputy Librarian, Indian Statistical Institute, Dr. Sheikh Abul Salam, Librarian, Shikhpur Dinobondhu Institutions, Dr. Tanmoy De Sarkar, Assistant University Librarian, University of Calcutta, Dr. Nivedita Bhattacharya, Assistant Professor, Department of Library Information Science, Vidyasagar Universities. A question answer session will be there after the deliberation of all the speakers. All the participants are requested to write your questions in YouTube chat box. We inform the participant that the feedback link will be provided in the YouTube chat box. You can download your certificate from BGC MOOCs. This program encouraged by our Honorable Vice Principal Dr. Sanjit Kumar Das, who is also chief patron in this webinar also. I request to our Vice Principal to deliver his welcome address. Over to sir.
Thank you, Mitu. Good afternoon and welcome all of you in this webinar, Online Teaching, Learning and Evaluation, jointly organized by the Infolib Academia and Bhairab Ganguly College. In fact, it is the second one of among the five series of webinar organizing by these two association and organization. Actually, in these days, webinar has a specific significance. Because everyone is sitting at home, and it is the only way to exchange the views and ideas and thoughts among the scholars. And our college has already organized about 15 webinar and international conference in virtual mode. So it is going tremendously. And in fact, I thanks the Infolib Academia for extending their hands to jointly organizing this series of webinar. In fact, in 2021, the third cycle NAC digit is due, so it is just knocking at the door. And our college has already graded A grade in 2016, so we are preparing ourselves so that we can score a better in the next cycle. So we are in the process in the different academic endeavors. So please stay at home, stay safe, and enjoy this session. Thank you very much. Please, Mintu, carry on.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable speech. Now I request my beloved teacher, Professor Biplab Chakraborty, chairman in this webinar, to introduce the speaker and say something about the Infolib and today's webinar. Over to sir.
Thank you, Mintu Haldar.
Good afternoon to all. Respected Vice Principal Dr. Sanjit Kumar Das and the teacher colleagues of the Bhairav Ganguly College, Professor Aurobindo Maiti, Vice Chairman of the InfoLib Academia, Dr. Tapan Kumar Mandal, the keynote speaker of this webinar, is the Deputy Librarian of the Indian Statistical Institute, Dr. Nivedita Bhattacharya from the Department of Library Information Science of Vidyasagar University. She is the invited speaker. Other invited speakers are Dr. Tonmoy Desharkar, Assistant University Librarian of the Calcutta University, Dr. Abul Salam, Librarian of Shibpur Dinobandhu Institution, Howrah, and Mr. Mintu Haldar, Librarian and Bursar of Bhairav Ganguly College and convener of this webinar. Dear participants, at the outset, I want to convey my gratitude and thanks to the organizers for inviting me to act as the director of this webinar. Already, Mintu has stated, our principal sir already has stated that this is the second day of the collaborative webinar between InfoLib Academia and Bhairav Ganguly College. Actually, as our main focus, or we are concentrating on the services of the academic library, that means libraries of the academic institutions, then mainly students and teachers are involved in it, mainly. So, due to the pandemic situation, we see that the institutions are facing serious challenges. Most of the institutions are forced to shut the doors to the college or university, whatever it may be, the students and the teachers of that institutions. So, because of the security and safety measures, so the authority as well as the teacher and students are facing serious challenges, serious problems, and to pursue their academic interest. So, at this juncture, the academic should be aware of the role of the services of the libraries of the academic institutions in relation to teaching, learning that may be online, and evaluation also as well, e-contents creation, development, organization and management, and the learning management system as well. So these are the areas the academic community should know. So we have started our journey on 20th August. Our teachers and the different professionals, they have discussed a lot on the services of the academic libraries. Professor Aurobindo Maiti, Dr. Subal Barui, Dr. Sudip Banerjee, Dr. Ashish Karan, and Ms. Bani Ghosh, all they are the respected professionals in their respective institutions, and they discussed a lot about the services. Today, in this webinar, that means that dates webinar is, we are concentrating on the teaching and learning and evaluation in the light of MOOC. And already Mintu has stated that MOOC is the online course which has access and interactive participants by means of the web. So this massive open online course will be discussed in detail by the speakers. They will discuss, I think, the nature, scope, types, and the origin and development activities, and the as well the merits and demerits also. So all the issues, all the things will be discussed in the webinar. and I think every participant is waiting for the speaker's speech. There, so we can hear also from the speakers. So I don't want to waste much time. I sincerely do request our honorable key speaker, Dr. Tapan Kumar Mondal, to deliver his keynote address. Please, Mondal sir.
Respected OIVNR Director, Professor Biplab Chakraborty, my mentor also, Dr. Sanjeev Kumar Das, Vice Principal of Nehru Graduate College, Mintu Haldar, Dr. Abul Salem, their professionals and participants. I am extremely happy and privileged to be part of a prestigious program, because definitely this program will be a thought-provoking program, and from the eminent speaker we will come to know a lot of things about this thing. As we are passing through a very difficult time due to this pandemic COVID-19, our normal life are at a stake. So before going to the exact topic, the MOOC, I would like to say about the application technology enhanced learning. That is, the application of technology in teaching and learning, which transform education and educational institution beyond the ecosystem. It is a standard of education that is expected today, which is also improve the quality of education by providing e-content such as video, audio, interactive learning. It is also transform the learning environment from the classroom teaching to self-learning and interactive learning. Then why should we use technology enough learning? Because it is crucial that we are flexible, that we are creating learning environment in which students can have deeper and more rewarding learning experiences. This technology enhanced learning, the outcome of this is MOOCs. MOOCs is massive, as we have already came to know that Meetu has already in his introductory speech. So I am giving a definition of Maxwell, that is, massive open online course are a mechanism of mass dissemination of information through an internet-based educational course to potentially very large and internationally distributed group of learners. MOOC engage thousands of students without geographical bounds simultaneously in an intranet-based virtual education and socialization experience. These are the components of MOOC. Massive means there may be 1 lakh, more than lakhs of students at a time. And it is open. Anyone, anywhere can register for this course. And it is available entirely in the internet. And course is very similar to the online courses of the normal colleges and universities. Another part is what actually component of MOOCs are. I want to show this in this slide. See, as I already mentioned, that lakhs of students can join. Registration is open, then local service. It is self-paced, start and end date is clear. College credit, like in colleges, application will also be there, evaluation is there, badges are there, role of instructor. So these are the some of the components of MOOC. Then historical development. First MOOC course was started in University of Manitoba, Canada by George Simmons and Stephen Gowen in 2008. in India, MOOC National Curriculum was made in 2013 by Ministry of HRD. 7 IITs and IIT Bangalore jointly started MOOC course under the project NPTEL. There are some UGC MOOCs are also there. From this degree, you can go to the details and find out what are the components of these courses. The university MOOC, IGNU, the Central University, Open University, IGNU is also running a lot of MOOC courses. Yet InfliNet is also running MOOC courses, that is UG Pascal. In 2018, more than 900 universities around the world had announced or launched 11,400 MOOC courses. Some MOOC characters. The main features of this MOOC course is the strong marketing social segment, profile of early adopting educators, different from some other types of e-learning early adopters, that is higher profile. Potentially more diverse learners external to the institution, not always integrated as normal part of learning and teaching, but possibly becoming same, different platforms from institutional virtual learning environment, high attrition rate, learners not necessarily aiming to complete but still want to enjoy the experience they have. Mainly in MOOCs, the model is in four quadrant approach. That is first quadrant e-text, second quadrant is e-tutorial and lecture, lectures and video, audio, and organized form, animation, simulation, virtual learning. Third quadrant is web resources, supplementary reading, wiki, glossary, related links, Wikipedia development of course, open content in internet, case studies, and many more. And fourth quadrant is self-assessment. There are multiple choice questions that will be there. Problems, quizzes, assignments, and solutions, online feedback through discussion forum, and setting up FAQ in general list. MOOCs, there are two types of MOOCs. Free MOOC is also known as Connectivity MOOC, which is originated in 2008 at the University of Manitoba by Stephen Jarrett, as I already mentioned, and which online community from around the subject of mutual interest, typically outside traditional educational context. This is collaborative project and participant of social network. XMOOC is based on more traditional classroom structure because they are a combination of pre-loaded, pre-recorded video lecture uploaded in the web with the quiz, test, and other assignments. XMOOCs are centered around a professor rather than around a community student. Example, EDX, Coursera, Udacity. So, in XMOOC, there is fixed element. The example of this Coursera and Udacity, the Canvas name, these are the fixed elements. And this is lifelong learning and more strict to the plan, XMOOC. Whereas, in CMOOC, it is social media rich, expert learning, a room for emerging. Next is major global MOOCs provider of the world. These are the some of the MOOCs provider in the world. The comparison of MOOC service provider. Allison from Ireland 2007, and their table shows the how much students they have included and what are the number of courses they are running. Certification fee, whether it is there or not, whether it is profit or non-profit, that table shows. You can go this article and have a look. Next, how MOOC is beneficial? MOOCs is relatively based here because it is free of cost and easy enrollment. Update one skill set by enrolling to the course of his heart choice. Participation of international academic community, encouraging collaborative participation, it increases institutional visibility and help for student admission, encourages interdisciplinary learning and financially viable for student community. Next is advantages, very, as we have already covered, that is free, it is affordable, flexible, quality education, anyone can participate and available 365 days and 24/7 services. Learning is fun, it is also interactive thing. And content, and I have already mentioned, the text are there, audio are there, video are there, interactive session are there, and chapters are there. MOOCs through Coursera, for example, internationally, this is very popular. They are running more than 100 courses. So recently, I have done a MOOC course through this Coursera course. It is copyright for educators and librarians. Participants who are working in the library, especially librarians, they can opt for this course. This is a very interesting course. It's only for 5 weeks. You can have a look. Then you can have a certificate also. This is a sample certificate. Then efforts in developing OER, that is Open Education Resource, massive open online courses in India. Two projects are there, NPTEL, National Program on Technology and Enhanced Learning, National Mission for Education through ICT, Information Communication Technology, and IIMBA, Ratnagar. Swayam is the main course. They are also running a lot of courses in India through Swayam. The Swayam, as Muntu has already mentioned, the study of web active learning for young aspirant minds is an integrated MOOCs platform for distance education that aims at offering all the courses from school level to PG level. The platform has been developed in collaboration with HRD, AICT, and Microsoft. They are running more than 2,000 courses till date. In Swayam interface, this is the portal. You can see swayam.gov.in. You can enroll yourself and you can join any course as per your requirement. Here also, I would like to say there are a lot of courses running on. The course duration are here, especially in Swayam, 12 to 16 weeks course. Generally, we are having 6 to 8 weeks courses in international level. But national level, we are observing that the course duration are little bit more to cover in detail. So this is also a sample certificate. Recently, we have done, I have also done this Swayam course. IIT Delhi has jointly organized in association with the AICT. So, librarians definitely will be helpful in their career advancement. So, you can do this course in electronics. After the COVID-19 scenario, the unprecedented shift to online teaching and colleges around the globe, Duke University is the first university to draw on MOOCs in response to COVID-19 on February 20. In March 17, 2020, MIT and Harvard University jointly made a non-profit MOOCs through EDX platform in remote access program. You can see this in www.mooc.org. In recent after the COVID-19, our scientists, ISI scientists, also responded some of the MOOCs working on this some project done by our government of India. Just I'll click here, you can see a lot of courses are in various subjects, modeling, analytics, sampling, pooling, service of our COVID-19 India timeline, resources, economics, computation, and any of one is interested, you can be in detail. And media coverage is also there. What are the media coverage? The list are there. This is our ISI scientist responded in COVID-19. So a lot of researches are going on. The limitation of books are there. As we have already mentioned, that the dropout cases are more. And next limitation is lack of technological infrastructure and lack of awareness also. That we are, because due to the COVID-19, we are forcefully shifted to print media, to online media. Likewise, in teaching learning also, with the help of the existing resources, we have to run our courses and we have to lead our degrees and diploma and other academic endeavors. So these are some of the reference you can go through for your detailed consultation. So I thank you once again for the organizer for giving me the opportunity to deliver my keynote address. I think other dignitary speakers will enlighten in detail on this particular topic. Thank you.
Thank you. Now I do request Dr. Nibedita Bhattacharya, Assistant Professor of the Department of Library Information Science of Vidyasagar University, to deliver her speech. Please, Nibedita.
Thank you so much, and indeed a very good afternoon to my respected teacher and this webinar director, who is also the mastermind of this particular webinar series, Professor Biplab Chakraborty, Dr. Shunjit Kumar Dash, the Vice Principal from Bhairav Ganguly College. Good afternoon, sir. The keynote speaker of today, Dr. Tapun Kumar Mondol, and my co-speakers, Dr. Tanmay Desharkar and Dr. Abdul Salam. And a very good afternoon to all the participants who are listening to me today. First, let me share the screen with all of you. I am going to share the screen with you. I am just sharing the screen. That is my presentation for today. Is it visible now? Is the PowerPoint visible? Please, anybody confirm me. Is the PowerPoint visible? Am I audible? Hello? Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Is the PowerPoint visible? Please confirm me.
No, PowerPoint is not visible still yet.
Please, I have just shared. Yes, I have shared just now. Okay, I'm sharing once again. I think it's coming now.
Yes, it is okay now.
Okay. So, good afternoon once again. So, I'm starting with this when the organizers actually asked me to say something and share my views regarding MOOCs, teaching, learning, and evaluation process. I thought of that, whether are MOOCs really effective? That is some evidences from India and abroad. This is my topic for today. I'm going with a few slides. A few quick slides, I will say. Already my previous presenter, Dr. Tapun Mondol, has spoken to some extent of these things. Still, the MOOCs overview that we have seen is that is David Wheely. He ran a campus-based course in 2007 and it made it open online to participate. As did Alec Torres, that is operating an open boundary course. However, the course developed by Stephen Downs and George Siemens entitled Connectivism and Connectivity Knowledge in 2008 got the title of founding MOOCs. Actually, this was the founding MOOCs. The title was the Connectivism and Connectivity. Right from the title, you can understand that is MOOCs is all about connectivity. We have to connect with each other, and the connectivity is the main issue in case of the MOOCs. The New York Times declared 2012 as the year of the MOOC, as most major US universities signed up to one or the other of the main providers or launched their own courses. So the year of MOOCs, it has been declared as 2012 because we have seen a tremendous rise in the MOOCs courses by 2012. Offered to the users for free by the companies like Coursera, edX, Udacity, and Google Course Builder, which spurred a national conversation about the size and shape of the higher education. So these are some of the very popular, very, very popular, all over the world, they're very, very popular companies. That is Coursera, edX, already my previous presenter, he has spoken of Coursera, he has already participated in that, and he said about that. And so that is one of the, these are some of the courses that are offered by these companies. In 2017, however, it seemed that what some had called the MOOC moment has largely passed. So already from 2012 to 2017, we have seen that there is a fall in some of the MOOC courses. People are not that much eager to learn. And also the MOOC courses were falling during that period of time, that is 2017. We have seen that. After that, my next slide. Just a minute. So these are some of the MOOC players in the MOOC universe. So this is the MOOC players, if you can see the screen very well. And this concept and text was given by Zarissa Holdaway. She was the creative media leader. She is the creative media leader, actually. And Nigel Houghton, who is the information designer. They have designed this MOOC universe by this means. And it has been covered in the Chronicle of Higher Education, Financial Times. That is the MOOC players. So it is seen that though millions of students who have signed up for massive open online courses, and hundreds of universities are offering some form of web-based curriculum, most students are not paying much for these classes, if they are paying anything at all. So where is all that knowledge and all that cash coming from? So this is a very big question, that though we are not paying anything for the MOOCs courses, then from where are we getting this money? So here you can see it's a very beautiful diagram, very beautifully explained. I have taken the screenshot from the internet. That is, here you can see the venture capital by these companies. This is the venture capital portion. And these are the companies, that is like Pearson, Google, San Jose State, UC Berkeley, UT Austin, Caltech. These are some of the companies who have, thus they have capitalized the courses. And this is the non-profit world who is making these courses famous. And if you can see, that is indicated by the colors, if you can see, that is, it is in maroon color, the investors, it is indicated by the investors. Investors, you can see in the maroon color, it is indicated here, that they have already invested $15 million, $16 million, like that, they have invested into these courses. And the donors are here indicated by means of the yellow lines. You can see that they have also donated a sufficient amount of money or capital to these courses. And the professors, they are indicated in the green color. It's not very much clear, but still I think you have to see it. So these are indicated in the green colors, who are the professors of these universities. There are certain alumni or the fellow, and the board members, they are indicated by in the, that is, violet colors, and others. So this is a very beautiful diagram. You can find it in internet also. Maybe this PPT may not be clear to you at this time. And it is available in the net. That is, they are the major players who are actually investing into this MOOC universe. Now the next one, that is the major forms of the MOOCs. Already my previous speaker, he has spoken about the X MOOC and the C MOOCs. So So still, I want to add some new points here. That is, the XMOOCs are basically the systems in which the instructors provides the video presentations to teach the course, while each student follows their coursework at their own learning speed. So the most well-known courses, that is the Coursera, edX, Udacity, Udemy, these are all the XMOOC courses, including ours, I am. So I am also. And CMOOC courses, they are actually, each learner structures and manages their own learning. They manage their own learning. They establish their personal learning network through the notes and the connections. And QuasiMOOCs, it is a relative simple resource management system which provides web-based open education resources. And some other forms include SPOCs, that is short private online courses, VOOCs, that is vocational open online courses, SOOCs, that is selectively open online courses, mini MOOCs, and mobile MOOCs, etc. So these are some of the major forms of the MOOCs. Next one. PPT is not being shared, I think. Not forwarding. Okay. Now, these are some of the MOOC statistics today. What are the MOOC statistics here? You can see that here I have provided the MOOC statistics, and it has been seen from Class Central. They are making a very good statistical study. That is the providers, universities, institutions, and languages. At present, there are 44 providers of MOOCs in number, which includes Coursera, edX, Swayam, among the most number of courses till date. Coursera is in the first top position, edX is second, and Swayam, it is providing third in the list. And there are 941 universities with IIT Kharagpur, University of Michigan, and Stanford University offering maximum number of courses. Here also, we can see that one Indian University, that is Indian IIT, Indian Institute of Technology, IIT Kharagpur, it is among the top most universities that is offering the maximum number of courses. And institutions, among the institutions, there are 541 institutions who are, that is, giving the, holding the top, there are 541 institutions providing these MOOC courses. That includes NPTEL, that is operated from India, Google, and Coursera Project Network that are holding the top positions. And 26 languages in which MOOCs are delivered. They include the English, Spanish, and French languages. So these are the providers. We can say the statistics here, and you can directly go to the classcentral.com site to see the statistics that is given. And they are also beautifully giving the very good, actually, the statistics of how many courses, how the courses are, from where you can learn, and all those statistics are very well given, or very well depicted on these things, actually. So actually, there is some problem with the PPT sharing here. Okay, just I'm just proceeding then. I'm stopping this and I'm proceeding. I think there is some problem in the sharing part. So now the MOOCs during the pandemic situation, actually the ongoing pandemic has increased the interest in the online education. That is 2020 web traffic. There is a diagram. I know that is there is some problem with the PPT sharing, but there is a diagram that is also made by the Class Central only. And it has been seen that the ongoing pandemic has increased the interest in the online education. On March 15th, Class Central, a search engine, that is Discovery Platform, and review site for massive open online courses, which provides a listing of online courses, noticed a big rise in the learners visiting their website. Since then, 15 million learners and maybe even a few celebrities, they visited those sites, and Class Central to look for the courses, sending 8.5 million clicks to the MOOC providers. So this has been seen that Class Central, it has shown a tremendous rise in the and a very good source also. It is also a very good source, and there that has been seen that the Class Central, they are just giving us the that is the statistics, everything we can get it from the Class Central, and we can start. We can actually start from the from those courses. We can start the courses from there. So since then, the 15 million learners and maybe even some celebrities, they have visited this. And 2020, that is web traffic, it has shown a huge rise during this pandemic. It has given a huge rise in this, actually, the MOOCs learning courses. The new registered learners during the pandemic. The top three MOOC providers are Coursera, edX, and FutureLearn. They are indicating that the top three MOOC providers are Coursera, since as a whole, since 2019, that is registered as many as new users in April. Over the years, the providers have become better at monetization, but in terms of new registered users, they had hit a growth wall, adding a similar number of users in both 2019 and 2018. And the pandemic broke through that wall. Around 25 to 30% of their total registered users on these platforms came after the pandemic. Coursera, they added the largest number of new learners, receiving 35 million enrollments between mid-March and by the end of July. So this is a very great statistics, and we know that as we are all homebound now and we cannot visit our institutions, so many of us are now already interested in taking part in the online courses, like these webinars. We are attending the webinars, we are going to the online courses also, and that is a very general intuition that we are getting nowadays. Now, most demanding subjects in MOOCs. These are some of the most demanding subjects. That is pre-pandemic. You can just see, if you can see the slide, that is pre-pandemic, computer science, programming, business, personal development, management and leadership, data science, artificial intelligence, information technology, career development, entrepreneurship. These were the pre-pandemic subjects. They were most followed, most demanding subjects. But as the post-pandemic situation, it has a huge change in that. A lot of changes has been seen, like personal development, business, art and design, management and leadership, self-improvement, humanities, computer science, communication skills, health and medicine, foreign languages. They have taken the places. And you can see how many lots of followers. There are lots of followers of these particular courses. So the most demanding subjects have also changed that from the pre-pandemic to the post-pandemic. Now, world MOOC providers during the pandemic. So when the universities started moving their classes online, or rather remote, Western MOOC providers were not part of the conversation. In China, the biggest MOOC providers also provide tools and services for on-campus students. This allowed them to grow rapidly when the spring summer went online in mid-term. Actually, by contrast, for the MOOC providers like Coursera, edX, and FutureLearn, growth didn't come from campuses going online, but from social distancing policies coming into effect worldwide. Class Central first noticed this surge on March 15th, actually. By the end of April 9th, million learners visited Class Central, compared to just 500,000 by the end of the term. And Coursera, they received over 10 million course enrollments in a 30-day period. Think of the situation. What is the situation all over the world? They have actually Coursera, this very good courses they are offering also. But they have received over the 10 million course enrollments in 30 days. And edX became one of the world's top 1,000 websites during that time. So now let us come to the Indian scenario, MOOC scenario in India. So you can see name of the MOOCs, that is Swayam, NPTEL, and the platform they are providing, that is being provided. They have at the website links also given. Swayam, NPTEL, MOOCit, IIT Bombay, IIMBX, and AgMOOCs. These are actually, you can see that MHRD and Microsoft, they have developed the Swayam. NPTEL, IITs, and IISC. MOOCit is developed by IIT Kanpur. IIT Bombay developed IIT Bombay X, IIT Bombay, and IIM Bangalore, they developed IIMBX, and IIT Kanpur, that is AgMOOCs. Now, general features are the most developed in the India. So these are some of the features. If you can see the slide, though it is very small, you can have to see it. That is the powered by, you can see the SWAYAM, NPTEL, these are the names of the courses just now I was speaking of. That is powered by, this SWAYAM is powered by SWAYAM, NPTEL, Drupal and OpenDX. So contact, powered by contact, browser, you can see. The learning model, you can see, that is SWAYAM has a blended learning model system. As well as MOOCIT, they have blended learning. Others are all online learning systems. Okay, and number of courses, also you can see that SWAYAM is offering the highest number of courses and all are free in that sense. Platform language, English and Hindi in SWAYAM. And others are English except MOOCIT. They are offering in English, Hindi, Kannada, French, Russian and Ukrainian. And IIMBX, they are offering in English and Hindi. So SWAYAM actually, they have started in 2016. But prior to that, in 2012, MOOCIT from IIT Kanpur, they have started the course. And after that, in 2014 also, that is IIT Bombay and IIM Bangalore, they have started their courses in 2014. So certificate, all of them provides the certificate. And mobile apps, that is Android, iOS, and Windows for this, it differentiates. And they are all available in the social network sites. Now the MOOCs under the SWAYAM courses. Actually, this is an important part, that is MHRD, that is Government of India, they have introduced the SWAYAM in the year 2016. And where teachers from the institutions such as IITs, IIMs, and the central universities offer the online courses to the citizens. And they have the 9 national coordinators, that is AICTE, NPTEL, UGC, CEC, NCERT, NIOS, IGNO, IIMB, NIPPTR. These are the 9 national coordinators of the SWAYAM courses. And UGC, they have declared that through the credit framework for online learning courses through SWAYAM, regulation to 2016, mentioned that at least 20% materials from the total number of courses by an Indian university should be released in the form of the MOOCs for the fast mobilization and dissemination of knowledge and information among the prospective learners. Course shall be of 2 types, that is credit courses and non-credit courses. Credit course, it means that a course which is taught for at least 1 sem, that is 1 semester, as part of the subject program, and non-credit courses shall include courses like awareness program, continuing education program, or training of specific skill set as independent courses, which is not part of any set curriculum. It can be of a shorter duration also. As per the report provided by Minister of State, HRD, Dr. Satyapal Singh, in Lok Sabha, till 2018, more than 39 lakh learners have been enrolled in more than 1600 plus MOOCs courses that have been run through SWAYAM. 60,000 persons have completed the courses, and credit transfer facility up to 20% is enabled through the notification issued by UGC or AICT. And that is, it is an endeavor of MHRD to align the courses on the SWAYAM portal with the curriculum of the university. And India Today, very recently, they have reported that AICTE has urged all the universities and colleges to allow up to 20% credit transfer in every semester through the central government SWAYAM on Sunday, that is May 18, 2020. See, very recent news this is. And the Minister of Finance and Corporate Affairs, Nirmala Sitharaman, she had announced on Sunday that the top 100 universities will be allowed to offer online degree programs from May 30, 2020. She has already announced this, and that has been started. Sitharaman also announced the PM eVidya program, bringing all the government online, distance, and on-air education projects to one platform. So you can very well understand that how they are giving the stress on the online education nowadays. And they're trying to promote these courses also. They're saying that there will be credit transfers if you do the online courses from the SWAYAM courses. So status of MOOCs offered to CEC, UGC and IGNO till April 2019. You can see here. This is from the source SWAYAM. That is, they have said that CEC, UGC and IGNO, they have compared the courses, partnering institutes they have mentioned, and UGC has the highest number of partnering institutes followed by CEC. Completed courses are highest in CEC and students' enrollment is also highest in CEC. Registered for the examination, you can see that the most number of students are registered in CEC. and followed by UGC and IGNO. And that of successfully completion is, you can see only the number is, you can see what is the percentage, that is 1625. That is, only passed out learners, successful passed out learners is 31.12, very poor I can say. And UGC, you can say 37.32 percentage have passed out. And IGNO, it's April 2019, I think probably they have not given any exam or they have not completed their exam. That's why it shows that 0% actually pass out percentage. So this is the scenario of Indian MOOCs till April, that is available till 18 April 2019. So these are the platforms you can see. You can visit these, that is swayam.gov.in, and you can find out your courses. And they are just this is they are seeing upcoming enrollment that is open and ongoing enrollment closed. They are making it. And just I have searched with a search term library, and they have shown that there are now at present open programs. There are 5 open programs running in the library, and you can see that which provider is giving it, that is IGNO, CEC, AICT, like that. They have already mentioned who is giving the course, that is the course coordinator, his or her name is depicted. Also the duration of the course also you can find, that is, it has been given 12 weeks or 15 weeks, when is the exam date and when is the enrollment ends, all of actually these, this is the, that is, this course will have an exam at the end, but this will not have, or this will not have. So actually they have mentioned also that which are the courses we are having the exams. So these are some of the filters that we have checked. I will subsequently check them in the other side. That is, you can see that they are the providers of this one. That is I have searched with the category, and it has come that the AICT, NITTR annual refresher program in ARPIT, that is ARPIT in teaching, that is ARPIT, architecture and planning. These are the courses running. Actually, they have divided the courses into the following subject or domains. So they have divided them, and you can see here that actually these courses, already my previous speaker has told about this, that they range from 4 weeks to 24 weeks. So it may be a 4 weeks duration, or 6 weeks, or 8 weeks, 12 weeks, 15 weeks, 16 weeks, or 24 weeks, like that. They actually cover the course duration accordingly. So here, now, a very important part for the college librarians, for the teachers. So API, that is academic performance indicator. So can API be scored through the SWAYAM? Yes, for each course there are points. And you can see the latest UGC Gazette notification published in July 2018. You can see here that the creation of ICT mediated teaching, learning, pedagogy, and content and development of new and innovative courses and curriculum. You can see that development of the innovative pedagogy, you will get 5 marks for that. Design of the new curriculum courses, 2 marks. MOOCs courses, you can see. Here you see that is the MOOCs courses, that is development of complete MOOCs courses in four quadrants, and everything has been given. Marks is also there. If you develop a course, then there is some marks for that. And that helps the, or that promotes the creation of the courses. So that's a great opportunity for the course coordinators, those who want to create the course, or those who can want to create some program or convey some program, they can just go and convey those. I think again there is a problem in changing the PPT. Anyways, I'm stopping. So there are some more MOOC courses in India. That is Shikshit India, B Skills, U18, Million Lives, Apna course, like those courses. Some of the more courses are there. They are not that much popular, but still they are running. Okay. So factors, some of the factors influencing the advancements of the online courses in India. Actually, overcoming the constraints of physical infrastructure and teaching resources. Basically, these courses, they are overcoming the constraints of physical infrastructure and facilitating the movement towards openness. It's all open. Like, we cannot go and visit now, actually, if we want to also to go to Harvard and get a course. No? But if we sit here and we get a course, it's pretty good that we can do with that if we are interested. So promoting development and practice of online and blended pedagogy to improve quality and scale within the existing university system is another factor which is influencing the advancement of online courses. And better recognition of online learning and even the online degrees. It's also one of the factors that is influencing the advancement. And what are the major challenges? Already, my previous speaker has spoken of the challenges. In India, what we are facing is that is there is challenge in creation of the digital content, because we it requires digital content developer other than the subject expert, and digital content that includes good voice, good video, formatted text. So creation of the digital content is a big challenge. Also the devices, the end devices used to view the digital content and if possible to download it. That is third is the internet access. One of the most important and the challenging factor is internet access and the speed. It requires a minimum bandwidth to access the online platform, which is major setback in rural part of the nation basically. Actually, we are not having the enough or good internet facilities everywhere. That's why there's a problem. You can also see now that there's a seeming problem here. Now the language barrier is another problem, which is causing another problem. It's a major constraint for the online education, particularly in India. Almost every online platform delivers courses in English and moves out to consider this factor and deliver the courses in multiple languages and adopt it in local context. So assessment and evaluation, that is another problem in that case. And the dropout ratio, this is a very serious problem, I can say. That only we can say that 5 to 10% of people will complete the entire course. It has been found from a study that only 5 to 10% they complete the course. The major reason may be the course duration and the motivation also to participate and continue with the courses. Also, there are economic benefits, that is personal growth and the professional identity. They are some of the factors which actually they may be not motivating the learners to continue with this course. Now I am coming to the conclusion part. And here I conclude that in this particular situation, we have to go with the new, in this new normal situation. Actually, blended learning is the new normal in the education. And across the world, particularly in the developed countries, more than 70% is delivered online. However, in India, we can say that MOOCs do not seem to be so popular till today, and it is accessible only to a small section of the society, mainly because of the digital divide. And the new social constructivism of lifelong learning that is being initiated through MOOCs in India should be a matter of serious scrutiny in the days ahead. And with this, I am thanking you all for being patient enough to listen to me. Thank you once again.
Thank you, Dr. Nivedita Bhattacharya. Thank you, my student. Very good speech indeed. A number of issues you have covered. I think the next speaker is thinking on which issue they will be speaking. However, I will say afterwards something because the speaker is important in this webinar. So I do request my professional colleague, Dr. Tolmoy De Sarkar, Assistant University Librarian of Calcutta University.
Hello, am I audible to all?
Deliver speech. Yes, yes, you are audible.
Hello.
Hi, you are audible. Hello, Tolmoy, audible.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm audible to all.
Audible.
Okay. Good evening, sir. Dr. Professor Biplab Chakraborty, Director Professor Dash, Vice Principal, Bharat Ganguly College, and my colleagues and friends, just allow me to say something about MOOC. This is a wonderful occasion where my previous two speakers spoke about MOOCs. I will pat down something about MOOC, then I will come to say something about what the librarians can play into this. Next slide. Next slide. I did the previous one. Anyway, in the previous slide, actually, unfortunately, the previous slide, So, I just want to say what MOOC is all about. Is it an institution offering teaching learning platform, or is it a course, or is it a simple tutorial platform, or is it something just conducting examinations and not conferring degrees at the end of the examination? What MOOC is all about? Next slide. See, like, if you think about the approach of MOOC, and in a very subjective way, yes, MOOC is definitely an online course. But if you think about it in a different way, like very objectively, then its periphery goes somewhat beyond what we say as a course. It's, you know, an immersive platform. And it's an immersive environment for all of them. This is an excellent platform which goes beyond what we say as a course. Next. Next. So the thing is that whether MOOC is open, is it available freely online? The answer is very skeptical, because MOOC is not that open, as every course is not open to all. As we see, like, for example, if we by IIT Guwahati, it conducts a course called, you know, rocket propulsion in aerodynamics. Intended audience are definitely not us. Intended audiences are, you know, and postgraduate students having degrees in mechanical engineering, having fluid dynamics with specialty, or simply from aerodynamics. So all courses are not open to all. At the same time, all courses are not free. There are some limitations. Why? You know, there are several courses that ask, you know, some amount of money as payment for certification. There are some courses that require payment for, you know, if someone writes something and get it corrected from that instructor, they need payment. They need to do payment for that. So there are payment aspect or economic aspect is there. Next slide. Now, MOOC model structure. See, like, entail. First of all, you want to register for MOOC. Then there is a course duration. It runs for 1.5 months on average. Then it clearly says the time commitment, like 2 hours, 3 hours, or 4 hours a day. Then it's language component, in which language the MOOCs will be delivered. Then mode of delivery, whether it is synchronous or asynchronous. Synchronous means whether it is self-paced or asynchronous based, instructed. If it's self-paced, you can download material at any time and you can read at your convenient time. Or if it's instructor-led, you have to wait for the time where the instructors, you know, sit in a webinar or some discussion forum and talk to all with the participants, you know, at the same time. Now comes top subject. Subject is based on which courses there, and it has been subdivided into topic A, B, C, and others. And another thing is platform, which is not important for us, for those who are at the recipient. But platform is different because every MOOC course needs a platform like Swayam platform, like a Coursera, Udacity, EDX, the platform on which books are hosted. Now, next important thing is assignment. The assignment in MOOCs are different ways. Like one is, you know, assignments are given to the students. They fill up the complete the assignment, then they upload. Now, whenever they upload the assignment, here comes the mode of assessment. The assessment of different types, like self-assessment, then some, what is it called? You know, peer-to-peer assessment, and then automated, machine-mediated assessment. Next comes, you know, the most important thing is the proctored examination. Whenever a MOOC course needs, you know, certification, a participant whenever needs a certificate for assessment, they need to pay something at this, after the certification, the credit is transferred to the record of the participants. It's something like, yes, it's something like, supposing you have, you are, pursuing three courses, like in our university or in our college, like physics, chemistry, mathematics. Supposing you are pursuing your college, but mathematics you are not pursuing there. You could directly pursue the mathematics course from any of the UGC affiliated MOOCs platform, like from Swayam. And after completion, your mathematics result will be credit transferred to your college or university. Here lies the beauty of this, you know, course. You can complete the entire subject. You can complete the, some of the papers of that subject. In any way, you can do it. So there is a synchronization between what you are pursuing in your college and pursuing what in your MOOC platform. There is, you know, it's a combination of approach. Next. Now, here comes the question of quality learning. See, like the term quality has been metamorphosed nowadays in online environment because ICT has is a huge enabler. ICT has actually enabled us to fight against this COVID pandemic. We are able to maintain the social distance, and at the same time, ICT enabled us to add values to the classes, as we are not, you know, conducting classroom teaching. So it adds values to the classes that results in improved performance of teachers and students, resulting in, you know, enhanced learning experience. Now the question is, there is a shift from teacher-driven to student-centric learning. Yes, majority of the online learning, what happens here, teacher speaks like at present what I'm doing, though I'm not a teacher in that sense, but a speaker speaks and audiences listen. But the thing is that this is a very not acceptable way if until and unless you involve audience. They cannot feel interested here. So teacher need to involve audience. Therefore, they feel interested. They don't get bored and then don't leave out the session. This is important. So how could you instill interest among the participants? Here comes the, you know, application of technology. While providing courses, you just add some of the, you know, audio visual messages. Now, audio messages will impact students. Video messages will make them interested. If you can't do anything, you just add some anecdotes. Anecdotal stories are very interesting. So in this way, you can integrate learners in your learning platform. So these are the ways you can improve the learning atmosphere. Podcast is a very simple technology. It requires, you know, a headphone, a computer, microphone, but that's it, with only, you know, internet connection. So yeah, this slide, thanks. So plus requires only this much of application, but beauty is, unlike other social media application which faces some sort of glitches, you know, noises and other things, podcast is a very smooth and simple. And another thing is that podcast will allow the recipients, it may be students, it may be participants, to listen to all these things at their leisure time. Moreover, this also resolves the problem of class overlapping. College students sometimes take the private classes. So whenever they take private classes, they will not be very much interested to take college or university classes whatsoever. So at that time, point of time, because whenever they, after finishing their individual classes, then they can listen to the podcast or vodcast as the case may be. Next slide. Next slide. Hello. There is a problem with slides swapping. Next, yeah. So another important thing is the library. Social media, librarians play a very important role here, because, you know, unfortunately, we Indians have major presence in social media. However, I haven't observed that much of presence of, you know, libraries or institutions or universities in social media, unlike what we see in the West. So if librarians make their institute or libraries whatsoever in social media, they could attract more and more participants, students and teachers. They can collaborate, they can integrate in the same area, and they grow their interest among others, and thereby they can improve teaching learning atmosphere. Next. Next. Another important thing is that actually we know how to create YouTube channels, but there are some teachers who may not know how to create YouTube channels. YouTube channel creation is very important. Librarians can help them out. Suppose someone in chemistry, some chemistry teacher, if they want to show any example of any experiment, they can take help of YouTube channel. And students will be particularly very important to see. For example, use of phenolphthalein or methyl arnold, what we have learned in our classes. That experiment, what the color of the hands-on experiment with YouTube, then the teacher will be much more accepted among the students' community. They feel much more at home with. This kind of things may be applied. Next slide. another important thing, how to access the supportive material, that is the course material and you know, teaching material and resource material with through library gateway. It's very important to produce some sort of apps like library toolbar or library you know, browser add-ons or plugins. That sort of things can, if users could install that add-on to their, say, like here, this is an example where you can just simply add this add-on. You could see beauties of the application. How? See, like whenever you add this application, you need not to search for any of the material to your library. Suppose you are in Google page, doing something else, but you require that particular book, whether it's, you know, library or not. For that purpose, you need not to go to your university page or your library page, then your search box, then put down the you know, keyword, then click on it. That sort of thing you need not to do that. Simply you click on this icon at your very browser extension, at that browser should directly, you know, take you to that book. This is the way approach how you know limit the time. It is very essential. Next slide. So this is an example of catalog search bookmarklet, where you click on this toolbar, this sort of pop-up box will appear, where you can search your material in any way you like. For that purpose, you need not to go to your university or your college or library or whatever. You need not to go. You are in the same Google page where you are staying. Without leaving your own searching page, you can search your book. This is the beauty of those applications. You can use this application to support teaching learning. Next slide. Next. That there are several types of browser extensions, and I'm not going to detail of all those. I'm going to say something like about the proxy bookmarklet. This is very important. Like whenever you search something and want to know whether this material is available or not, you just click on it, drag it, and drop it in your bookmarklet icon, which is there in your browser. And at that time, that icon will clearly lead you to your library and will fetch the exact book or exact document or exact course item or material that you need. This is the beauty of this application. Next slide. This is another application of library toolbar, where you can do all these things. Only you need to download a software which is freely available. You can, with this software, you can do all these things and send it to your participants. They can just install for the time being in their as long as they need. Next slide. Next slide. Yes, this is another very important application. We search Google Scholar for our resources. But at times what happens, we have observed that against some of the resources, there are icons like Find It in Harvard University or in Oxford University. That sort of link is nothing but SFX or link resolver. The librarians can create this sort of link resolvers to make resources accessible in a very quicker way. We have no preference in Google, because Google preference setting options are there, which requires half of the time of creating a Facebook account. So it's very easy to create a Google preference. But to except it takes time, but librarians can easily do it. Tools are available, you know, tutorials are available, and librarians can easily do it and create these SFX link so that whenever the students, if it is possible, if librarians want, they can create those link, and students, when they, you know, we often search Google Scholar for resources. What is Google Scholar? It's nothing but an abstracting database. So Google Scholar never has a link to a full text database. They doesn't have links to, you know, proprietary database. So they don't have to access all those databases. So librarian can use this SFX link, and librarians, the resources that libraries have in their possession, they can make it available through this link, particularly in this online, this COVID situation where, you know, approachability to physical library is a very tough time. Next slide. Next slide. Yeah. Now it's how URL link resolver works. URL link resolver, actually, URL link resolver taps the open URL. Open URL is nothing but the descriptive metadata of a book or, you know, article. Open URL link resolver is a software. Whenever we search a database, like abstracting database of, you know, Web of Science or Scopus or Google Scholar, the open access link resolver quickly access the open URL of our search term, and it decodes and quickly converts it into a full text. Like, it goes to the full text database, searches the most appropriate full text, and that full text to us. This is the way open access link resolver works. So if we put the open access link resolvers, or, you know, then it will be next. Now, this is one of the most important thing is the setting of virtual library. The virtual library is something different, because virtual library which is really virtual in true sense of term, because it doesn't have any library wall. It is totally a 3D library. And in this 3D library, you can find the essence of all library, all teaching, teacher librarian, you know, integrated platform. You can create integrated platform. You can create the atmosphere where can teachers and students sit for, you know, any live webinar, and everything, every you know, kind of environment where you can instill the sense of immersive learning, where integratedly all participants and teacher can sit and discuss, they clear their doubts, applying these platform is possible. And one most important thing is that librarian, with the help of this visual library, virtual library, can do another important thing. Like you know, in courses where chemical experiments are needed, virtual library gives the opportunity for the students to do chemical experiments like ring tests and any other thing virtually, sitting at their home with the help of computer simulations using this virtual library. This is very important and very helpful for the students. So if you go for this virtual library like thing, then it will be much more interesting for the students. They can learn by themselves, and with the help of the teacher, the teaching learning will be much more, you know, acceptable. Thank you. Next. This is a picture of a virtual library where, you know, this is Stanford University. You could see this is the figure. This is not a human figure. This is, you know, this is the creation, which is called avatar. And we cannot deny the fact nowadays we are moving towards more as not education rather than edutainment. The more and more we accept the social media and other applications, we are more moving towards gamification. The more we move towards gamification, more we could involve, more we could establish the immersive learning. So we are really moving towards gamification. So I am indicating that gamification technology or gamification in education, which is called edutainment. Next slide. This is a group discussion forum. This is an online group discussion forum, but in a virtual environment where you could see none of the participants are real. These are the avatars of real participants. So you represent in a virtual library as an avatar, not as yourself. So this is the way you could interact. You could come in touch with others. You could collaborate and you could improve the education system as such. And you know, towards the progression of academic advancement. That's it. Thank you for being with me.
Thank you, Dr. Tanmoy, for your nice presentation, but that time is short. The next speaker is on the scene. I do request Dr. Abul Salam to deliver his lecture, please.
Good afternoon, everybody. And thank you very much for our all the speakers who have delivered a great speech for our valuable updation. And in this scenario, particularly in the concept of MOOCs, they have very much enlightened us in different aspects of the elements and topics of MOOCs. Particularly our specific area is online teaching, learning, and evaluation. Dr. Bharchaj and our keynote speaker, Dr. Tapun Kumar Mondol, and lastly Tanmoyda, they have placed a very nice deliberation. So almost they have covered all the areas of this particular topics, and I just would like to concentrate to some of these core areas which already they have told. At first, I just like to share my screen. So, so today's topic is, we all know that MOOC, online teaching, learning, and evaluation. So if you concentrate how it will be teaching and how it will be learning by the, because teaching learning is very much related with the teachers and learners as well. And teachers have to prepare their contents and materials for the students, considering their topics and subjects and syllabuses. And after that, students have to learn, and then evaluation process. It is also a very important element of MOOCs nowadays. So MOOCs, a different educational space boundary is institute or university. We all know that university or institute should be boundaryless, as in the concept of blended learning. There we will have to fix the electronic learning interface as well as physical learning methods or systems. So if you consider the four terms, that is massive, large enrollment numbers, already our first keynote speaker, Dr. Mondal, covered these areas. Large number of numbers should be must have to accommodate in the system, and with the help of a learning management system, we all know that without any platform, without any system, learning management, either it may be learning management or it may be learning platform. Please unmute anyone who is on the screen. Please unmute. Sorry, mute. Sorry. And then it should be open. Not only open for in respect of course material or course content, it should be open for all. That means no mandatory qualifications are required in general. Particularly in our country, I will concentrate in our country's scenario. So it should be open. So no mandatory qualifications should be there. And the courses must be online. So without having an online platform, without having an online infrastructure in layout for all students and teachers, the course must not be run. And content must be structured. So this layout and this concept is provided by our MHRD, NME ICT project. Already told Dr. Bhattacharya and Dr. Mondal in respect of discussing the Indian scenario, particularly Swayam. So I will concentrate on the two aspects. Already first is MOOCs and initiative under NME ICT, which is very much related with Swayam and other platforms. And there are 9 collaborators already told by Dr. Bhattacharya. That would be very much concentrated with one-stop web and mobile-based interactive content for all courses from high school to university level. And latest, with the help of an order, you all know that on 26th December 2019, UGC sent and mailed to all the colleges and universities to register their, particularly with the attention of the universities. University has to approve those courses, and later the university college teachers also be the mentors of the course. So that in university level, on that order, UGCRO already described that there are 44 and 42 UGPG courses are there. And another part is, for that purpose, students can adopt the MOOCs for credit transfer, already told Dr. Bhattacharya. Because 20% credit transfer already will be there. UGC has already, in 19th May 2020, published an order telling that they will be within June or July. After that, they declared that from September the new session may arise, but I think it will be far deferred. On that order, they told that the credit transfer will be happen after conducting the MOOCs courses via Swayam platform or any other approved credit transfer related platform, because there are 9 national coordinators are there already. NPTEL, they have a separate NPTEL chapters also. They have registered their NPTEL chapters in different, they have given the permission in different institutes also. And luckily our institute also has the is the local chapter from West Bengal. There are 9 institutes from West Bengal. I am the coordinator of that local chapter. So they develop a lot of courses, and with the help of this local chapter, the students and faculties may also register their name as the course conductor or as a student, and any specialized faculty may register him or his as a mentor of the course, so that course can be conducted. And in case of certification, you have to register and pay something to face the examination taken by the body time to time. And next,
we can concentrate the four quadrant approach, which tail under NME ICT order. Already there is a guidelines developed and published by the NME ICT for Swayam platform. So in quadrant one, they are telling that this is a youth tutorial which shall contain video and audio content in an organized form. Animation, simulation, video demonstrations, virtual labs, etc. MHRD also trying to develop a virtual lab with the help of the mobiles, as far as the network is a vital issue in our interior, which we all know that network is not there in our country everywhere. So a teacher or course conductor or course manager or course creator has to develop the video and audio content. That is the must, which is quadrant one. So anyone can, with the help of the video, which a mobile phone also can create a video, or with the help of the mobile phone can also create the audio content, and particularly within very short duration of time. As per UGC NMEIC norms, they are saying that maximum duration should be within 25 minutes. So I think it may be reduced to 10 to 12 or 15 or 20, as because we have to concentrate to the students, we have to engage of the students, so that if it is very long, they may feel very bored. So, and with this audio video, if we integrate the animation also, there will be more, the course will be, the content will be more attractive, the lecture would be more attractive. So that is why we have to concentrate on that particular area when we will create the content. And in case of quadrant two, that is the e-content, that is very vital. We shall contain PDF, text, e-books. So in addition to the video audio content, we have to create the e-content. That may be in PDF, text or e-books, illustration in case of particularly practical cases, video demonstrations may be there, documents and interactive simulation however required. And depending on the syllabuses and course structure, the teachers or the instructor has to prepare this. And there are a lot of tools also available so that a faculty may create his PDF or text content as per his own. We all know that there is a cash benefit also is there in creating e-module. If it is approved, then we will get 10 for our API purpose. So there are a lot of tools like Google Docs is there also. If we create any, open the Google Docs and deliver our lecture in English, automatically type will be there, automatically the text will be written on the screen, and we can save it and share it to the students. And next, in quadrant three, that is a web resources, which shall contain related links, Wikipedia development of courses. This quadrant is very much related with the web content, that which resources is available, openly available. And we should have concentrated with the Creative Commons licenses. If the license permits, then we can share it. At the time of sharing, we have to much more concentrate on that particular topic so that we can create it or we can cite this. And the LMS or learning management platform should support that infrastructure so that we can tag our resources. In very beginning, we can develop this, or we can use it in Google Classroom or in other LMS like OpenEDX or Moodle or Canvas or Blackboard, etc. There are a lot of open source learning management system. You can also use this. So anything is available in the web resource, we can tag it. And last approach is a self-assessment. In case of assessment, we all know assessment is a very much challenging system in our MOOCs platform. So if we go for in our institute, so to implement these type of activities, so self-assessment purpose, we have to very much carefully on that respect. How to, particularly in short question or MCQ based questions, we can have evaluation system using Google Form or SurveyMonkey or other applications are there. But in case of long answer, descriptive answer, there are also a lot of tools are there in Google Classroom. There are rubric is a features is there. With the help of the rubric, we can evaluate the long answer also. And in case of Moodle and other learning management system, Moodle is the inbuilt features to evaluate the long answers for the student. So this is very important. This is the four quadrant approach. And these are the national coordinators. I am skipping this, as I already told by our respective Bhattacharya, Nivedita Bhattacharya. He's delivered a good thought. These are the bodies. They are developing. They are responsible. UGC for non-technology post-graduation, NPTEL for technical engineering, and CEC, that is Consortium for Educational Communication, they are non-technology undergraduation, IGNU for diploma, CBSC, NCERT, and NIOs for CBSC operation, plus 9 to 12, AICT for technical, and IIME for management related, NITTR, not only management related, NITTR is also for technical purpose, and other things also they are developing, particularly in research, technical writing purpose, they are also incorporating nowadays. And a lot of courses are there in some platform developed by them. And NITTR, Chandigarh is the main responsible body, for this development. And other NITTR's faculty members also are related with this project. And adaptive MOOCs for credit transfer. There is the steps already mentioned by UGC MOOCs. Already UGC MOOCs platform, there is a link for our registration purpose. We can register there to as a mentor, and we can submit also a proposal for developing e-content. They're also accepting this. If you visit ugcmoocs.inflipnet.ac.in, we can have this login facilities and registration facilities. Anyone want to, any faculty member want to register there, they can go there and register and submit their proposal. UGC's NMEICT, through NMEICT, CEC also is there, funding a lot of up to 12 lakhs for this purpose. And there is a huge project, and there are different combinations and features and characteristics they have already mentioned, how you will have to create the content, what will be the duration, what will be the features of your video, what will be the features of your content, how the content will be created. All these regulations are there mentioned by them. And I am particularly concentrating here, adopting MOOCs for credit transfer. So first, make amendment. They are telling that university has to go through their ECAC or BOSS, Executive Council, or any other bodies. Which university belongs to the authority. So they have to go through their authority and should make amendment in their ordinance, rules, regulation to incorporate provisions for transfer of credits for MOOCs courses as per UGC regulations. So until and unless university amendments their ordinance, rules, regulation, credit transfer will not happen. Although UGC already declared with their order that credit transfer should provide by the or accepted by the university. Then select the course. University shall select the courses. Already list of courses sent by the UGC URO with the email of 26 December 2019. I don't know whether the why the universities are delaying on this respect and accepting this platform or this credit transfer system. The load of the university or colleges will be reduced with this system. So university should accept this. Permitted for credit transfer through SWAM, that is courses in high demand for which faculty is not available, elective courses, or for supplementing teaching learning process, while ensuring that physical facilities like laboratories, computer facilities, library, etc. required for the course are made available free to the students in adequate measure. And then designate course coordinator. After selecting the course, university have to designate the coordinator or facilitator to guide the students throughout the course and to facilitate conduct the lab or practical session examinations. Like coordinator, he has to play a lot of role. And then disseminate information. The university should widely disseminate information about selected courses and motivate the students through faculty members, notice boards, student forums, workshop and university website, etc. Course registration. University to facilitate registration of students, every student enrolled the course in the university must register for the MOOCs course. And then evaluation purpose. The host institution shall evaluate the students registered for MOOCs course based on discussion forums, quizzes, assignments, sessional and final examinations, the university to assist host institution in conducting the final examination. Actually, NPTEL already they have playing a lot of roles, and they have leading from the front in this respect. And also, marks of the student, the university shall incorporate the marks or grade communicated by the host institution in the final mark sheet of the student, which counts for award or degree diploma. However, the university shall evaluate the students for the practical or lab component and incorporate these marks or grades in their overall mark sheet of the student. So, mark sheet, there should have mentioned these things, how much marks they have graded from this open courses or MOOCs courses, that must be declared in their mark sheets. And here, certificate on receipt of MOOCs completion certificate from host institution, the university to give equivalent credit weight up to 20%. So we all know that. And another thing is there, I should like to mention that already four credit courses a institute can host or a student can develop. And overall, our CBCS system also, they have conduct the up to 20% course credit from anywhere which supports universities or support UGC credit course. From that platform, students can conduct the courses, and later on receipt of the certificate, they have to submit to the controller section, and then that should be for the credit and SWAM. No university shall refuse, and controller section must have to incorporate in the result section. Here they also mention UGC that no university shall refuse any student for credit mobility of courses earned through MOOCs. So we can imagine that from this, they are motivating the students as well as teachers for conducting such type of courses. And if you go through this letter, already 19 May 2020, they have declared this result. And they're telling us this is for continuation of Honorable Chairman UGC letter of event number DOF, etc., etc., dated 27-20, regarding acceptance of MOOCs course offered on SWAM platform for credit mobility as per UGC credit framework for online learning course through SWAM regulation 16 and first amendment on May 18, 2017. In this paragraph, in the prevailing, we will concentrate here. In the prevailing COVID-19 scenario, universities and colleges are encouraged to make the optimum use of the SWAM online platform for the benefit of the students. The list of 82 EG and 4G MOOCs courses which are approved by the SWAM board and readily to be offered in July-September 2020 is enclosed herewith and may also be sent at SWAM portal at https://swam.gov.in/cc, that is Center for Educational Consortium. They are the main responsibilities body. They are creating these courses and accept it. And if you go at last, this is the link. If you go this link, we will go all the list of courses. These are the courses. And these are the titles. What are the degree programs, subject category, course, academic writings, etc., different titles are there. And SWAM links also mentioned is there. So these are the courses approved by the UGC. Any students who enrolled, so they should have got the credit facilities on their mark sheet. With this, they can also reduce the facing of a physical classroom pressure. And parallelly, in addition to the physical classroom, they can also conduct this 20% credit transfer course. And these are the UGC MOOC sites. These are the UGC MOOC sites. Here, if you visit, a lot of courses of in download tab, there are a lot of rules and regulation mentions here. If you go there, how you will submit your proposal for non-technology PG MOOCs for SWAM. Here also a lot of guidelines are there. If anyone wants to know, you can visit here. You can see that things. And here, with these guidelines, UGC also tell that how the quadrant or repurposing the e-content features of MOOCs compliant e-content will be there. This is the guidelines. Actually, this is 19 pages guidelines, MOOCs, massive online guide, open online courses, and initiative under National Mission NMEICT Program, Guidelines for Development and Implementation. This is the guidelines. If you want to know further with the MOOCs in Indian respect, particularly by the government site, you can go there. And if you visit CEC site, they are also there. Actually, with the UGC now, CEC is playing a major role. And as a CEC MOOCs, you can enroll here, you can register here. If you want to know further, you can visit also there. And these are the coverage of my discussion. And I just want to show some practical aspect of which I have already tried to implement in my organization. So with the help of the learning management system, and this is the platform we've in considering with the four quadrant approach. If we visit the site homepage, this is the homepage, and there are a lot of webinar series we can see also incorporate. These are the topics. Anyone, any teacher who create to submit their e-content can create here with the help of their login ID platform. This is the topics. In the left, these are the subject category. You know that my college is under University of Calcutta. So these are the subject categories. With this, the topics and this which for which Department of Mathematics, BSc Honors General, and it will be for the semester four course or general elective four course. For there, it can be used. And if we click on any of these, then we will enter on the as a student. So you can see here, a teacher may have the lesson plan. He can create the lesson plan for the student. And you see that lesson plan for semester four, course eight. And this is the unit of that particular topics. Improper topic-based discussion may be there, or anyone can create the courses for weekly based. So in unit two, that is improper integral for mathematics part. You see that study material one. So he has only uploaded the content, only uploaded the PDF content for the student. So students can download on that particular topic which he wants to conduct or which he wants to consult. And anyone also can upload here his video or audio also. If you go through here, you can see that audio lecture is here. So if you click on the audio will be already available.
তোমাদের সাথে আপাতত যেহেতু সামনাসামনি দেখা হচ্ছে না, এখন যা কিছু পড়ানো হবে সবটাই এরকম মেটেরিয়াল দিয়ে এবং অডিও প্রোভাইড করে। তো আগের দিন তোমরা রেশনাল এক্সপেকটেশন খানিকটা অর্ধেকেরও বেশি প্রায় পড়া হয়ে গিয়েছিল, পড়েছি।
সো লাইক দিস এ অডিও লেকচার মে বি আপলোডেড টু দি পোর্টাল অর এলএমএস পোর্টাল ফর দি বেনিফিট অফ দি স্টুডেন্টস এন্ড already we can also upload the video lecture also like this. Anyone, any faculty want to upload their video, they can also upload the video. Students can also.
Hello students, welcome to my video lectures. Myself, Dr. Shubhendu Majumdar, Assistant Professor in Zoology of Shibpur Dinobondhu Institution College. Today, I am going to show you the karyotypes of some congenital human disorders.
Like this, and in case of in this way we can create or we can upload our videos here. These are the activities. These are the actual lot of things are there. We can add here with the help of add an activity. This is a very practical things, and you will be later in our further practical session for this. If anyone want to have interest, there are a lot of options are there. With the help of this, we can have this. With the help of URL, we can have add any URL. We have already learned that in UGC quadrant 2, quadrant 3, there is options to link the web resources or web materials with the help of URL or with the help of labeling or page or file. We can have link the embedded code. We can have download our lecture, video lecture or audio lecture in YouTube or any other platform. then we can link or embed the video or audio or URL link here with our learning management system. And evaluation part, we can also have this evaluation option, or we can have also with the help of assignment, we can provide the assignment to the students with the framework, time framework, and we can have the evaluation option also. I have already told us earlier that the long answer, evaluation of long answers is very much useful with the help of this type of learning management system. Not only the with the help of quiz here, with the help of quiz, we can evaluate the short answer script or MCQ script, MCQ like type of evaluation. And with the help of assignment, we can have the long descriptive type of answers. So these are the useful tools you can use personally as well as institutionally. You can use personally, or you can develop of your own website, personal website for academic purpose. And with the help of these tools, you can have the link to the students for the benefit of their learning approach. And with this, I would like to conclude. Thank you very much for patient hearing.
Yes, Dr. Abul Salam. We are really hearing with patiently, because I think that there is no questions in the chat box. So every speaker, from keynote speaker to every speaker, may be visible. So I think that though we have already crossed the time limit, but from keynote address to last speech of Abul, with taking recognition of Nivedita and Tonmoy, I must say that basically for myself and every participant will be much informative, will much be informed about the MOOC for teaching, learning, and evaluation cases. Because from the keynote address to Nivedita, what I've seen that they have addressed a number of issues. What are the components of MOOC, types, beneficial areas, the merits, demerits, etc., and what are the efforts in developing MOOCs? Dr. Tapan Mandal, the keynote speaker, has discussed. But in Nivedita's speech, we find more, much more. Hello, Abul.
Yes, sir. Carry on.
Sound is coming.
Please, others are requested to mute themselves.
So, overview of MOOCs has been presented by or discussed by Nivedita. Who are the major players in MOOC universe? What are the major forms of MOOCs? She has given the statistics in relation to the providers, university institutions, and languages. What are the numbers of the registered cases in MOOC during the pandemic situation? All she has given very nicely in her speech. Moreover, the demanding subjects, what I come to know that during the pandemic, post-pre-pandemic and post-pandemic situation, and all MOOC providers during the pandemic and Indian scenario, which Nibedita has very rightly stated. So moreover, what are the institutions more are playing as coordinators, and what are the problems in developing or introducing MOOC in our country? She has stated, and mainly, she has told about that the blended learning from normal to new normal, and the limitation of digital divide. That means eradication of digital divide is the important step to create the MOOC online teaching learning evolution case. And what Tonmo's speech is, mainly because he asked that, is it really open to all and available the online freely? And he starts with questions, and the questions he has answered very nicely. He has answered very nicely, though network problem or network connection is there in viewing the slide sharing cases, but he has told very nicely about the role of the library and how they will be playing a catalytic role to support the teaching in learning cases. So to support the teachers, librarian may help in more and to get access of the resources and the teaching materials, how the students will get more help from the librarians. Tonmo has stated all these. So these are the areas Tonmo, Nibedita and Topol stated. And lastly, Abul, what is support? In support of MOOC, he has told that what should be the responsibilities of colleges and universities in introducing MOOC, what are the modalities to be introduced, the procedures of application in teaching learning evaluation and credit transfer facilities, and a lot he has told. And later he has shown the application slide, what he has developed, and through his audio and video slide. So I think that all the speakers who are in the this webinar have stated their speech within a short time period. That means within 20, somebody has taken 25, somebody has taken 30 minutes maximum. So within a short time span, it is not possible for anyone to discuss everything. So, but you have justified everything. I think so all these lectures are very much informative, and I have been informed particularly, and all participants, I think they will be beneficial from your lecture. Thank you. Thank you all. Now I, my microphone is handed over to the convener for continuing. Convener, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes.
Thank you, sir. Now I request our beloved teacher, Professor Dr. Aurobindo Maiti, to deliver his vote of thanks. Over to sir. Sir, unmute Kurun.
Yes.
Okay. Am I audible? Okay. Am I audible?
Yes, yes.
Oh, yes, sir.
Okay. Good afternoon to everybody. We are at the end of this webinar, and it's the turn for providing the vote of thanks. On behalf of the InfoLib Academia and Bhairav Ganguly College, and on my personal behalf, I convey my heartfelt thanks to Dr. Biplab Chakraborty, Professor, Department of Library and Information Science, University of Calcutta, and Webinar Director, for being present within his busy schedule and smoothly conducting this webinar and providing it valuable speech, which really enriched us a lot. I convey my heartfelt thanks to Dr. Sanjit Kumar Das, Honorable Vice Principal of Bhairav Ganguly College, for continuous inspirations and providing permissions to conduct this webinar, and also physically present and providing his valuable speech, which really enlightened us a lot. I convey my heartfelt thanks to Dr. Tapan Kumar Mondal, Deputy Librarian, Indian Statistical Institute, for accepting our offer as keynote speaker in this webinar and presented a nice thought-provoking lecture, definitely through which we are really enriched ourselves. Again, I convey my thanks to Sir. I convey my heartfelt thanks to my university colleague, Dr. Tanmay Desarkar, Assistant University Librarian, University of Calcutta, for providing his nice speech, definitely through which all of us present in this webinar benefited a lot. I convey my heartfelt thanks to my student and one of the speakers of this webinar, Dr. Nivedita Bhattacharya Sao, the Assistant Professor of Department of Library and Information Science, Vidyasagar University, for providing her valuable speech. I think all the persons who are attending this webinar really benefited a lot. I convey my thanks to Dr. Sheikh Abul Salam, Librarian, Sheikhbud Dinobandhu Institutions, Howrah, for providing it valuable speech and live demonstrations. Really, we received a new light in the new arena. In this platform, I want to say one thing, that the technical support, whatever we need for conducting such type of webinar, he provided by his master brain all the time. I convey my thanks to Dr. Sheikh Abul Salam. I convey my thanks to Sri Mintu Haldar, Librarian of Bhairav Ganguly College and convener of this webinar, for arranging new environment for smooth conducting several webinars continuously during this pandemic situation. I really thank you, Mintu, for your continuous enthusiasm. I convey my thanks to all the participants, professional colleagues, faculty members of this Bhairav Ganguly College and all the other institutions, and other research scholars and students who continuously watching this webinar, without whom the webinar can never be a grand success. Again, I want to convey my thanks to all of you. Thank you. Thank you all. Okay, now what to mention?
Thank you, sir. Thank you once again, our respected speakers. And my sincere thanks go to our esteemed participants who have joined this webinar. I have an announcement that we are going to organize another 5 more webinars. Out of 5, 3 webinars are organized collaboration with Bhairav Ganguly College, and 2 webinars are organized collaboration with Sarsuna College. Webinars are e-content creation, organization, management, and challenges and ways, which will be held on 29th August 2020. Number 2 webinar is implementation of learning management systems, problems and prospects, which will be held on 31st August 2020. Number 3, virtual library service during COVID-19, challenges and ways, which will be held on 1st September 2020. Number 4 webinars are tools and techniques for preserving the library documents in the present situation, which will held on 3rd September 2020. The connecting innovation and dissemination of the result on health issues to the common people, ways and challenges, which will be held on 10th September 2020. I requested all participants to register for our next webinar. With the permission of the chair, I conclude the session. Thank you, sir. Thank you once again, all the participants and all the speakers.